So next, let's code our Perceptron in Python. For that, we will use a Python class called Perceptron. And here we will start with an init constructor where we initialize the weights and the bias units. By the way we code this here will also be very similar to PyTorch later, so we will have a smooth transition from plain Python to PyTorch in the upcoming units. So here in the init constructor, we have numFeatures, which refers to the number of features in our dataset. So then we initialize the weight vector, which contains the weight parameters equal to the number of features in the dataset. And yeah, we initialize each weight to zero. And similarly, we also then initialize the bias unit to zero. So this is all there is for now for the initialization. So actually, let's create a new Perceptron object. And since our dataset only has two features, we set numFeatures to equal two. So just to make sure everything worked correctly, let's double check the weights, which should return a vector of zeros, which is indeed the case. We can then do the same thing for the bias unit. Looks all good to me. So this was a warm-up exercise. Of course, we still need to implement the forward function or the computation graph of our Perceptron. So let's actually take this code and extend it slightly. So we are now coding the forward function of the Perceptron, which will perform this computation here to compute the weighted sum. So the forward method, which computes the weighted sum, takes the features as input, x1 and x2, which we will call x here. And then we will use a for loop, similar to what we discussed in the previous videos, to compute the weighted sum. So essentially multiplying each feature with the corresponding weight here. And then we are summing this up in the for loop here. And plus equals one will essentially update the weighted sum z until we iterate it through all the features in our data set. But no, this is for one training example. Then after computing the weighted sum, we can also directly apply the threshold to obtain the class label. So here, similar to the video, we say if the weighted sum is greater than zero, we return class label one. Otherwise, we will return class label zero. So that's actually it for the computation graph of the Perceptron. So let's actually see if this works. So we initialize a new Perceptron, now this updated Perceptron, and then we have an example data point with feature value 1.1 and 2.1. So let's put that through our forward method of the Perceptron and see if it works. Yep, indeed it worked, so the output is zero. Why is it zero? Because our weights are still zero, so everything we put into this Perceptron will return the class label zero. So in this case, this is a Perceptron that will never really learn anything useful. So the next step that we have to take here is to implement the update function that will update our weights and the bias unit. So for that, let's take our existing Perceptron code and add an update method to it. So the update method takes two inputs. First, the feature values for that training example, and then its true class label. So remember from the previous videos how we compute the error. For that, we need the prediction, which we compute by the self.forward method, which we just implemented previously. So we then have the error here, which we compute from the true class label minus the prediction. And with that, we can perform the update. As you remember, we update the bias unit by adding the error term to it. And vice versa, we update each weight parameter by adding the error term times the feature value. So we do that actually for each possible feature value in our data set. So once we have the error value, we update the bias unit. And of course, we also update the weights here. So here for the weight update, we are iterating through each weight, and the number of weights is equal to the number of features. So we essentially, for each weight, we update it by the corresponding feature times the error. So actually, let's try out our code in practice and see if this Perceptron is able to learn. So here we initialize our updated Perceptron now, and then we use the same training data point. And we pretend the true class label here for this one is 1. So here we see the output 1, and that's because we have this return of the error in the update function, just as an indicator that an update is actually happening. Now let's check the model weights and the bias unit to see if they have been updated successfully. So as we can see, the weights are now similar to the feature values here, and that's because our update is 1 times the feature values. So now we have these updated weights of the Perceptron here, and we can also see that the bias updated correctly. So this value 1.0 comes from the fact that we are adding the error to the bias unit. So now we are very close to actually training our Perceptron on the whole data set. So what we do is now we are implementing a train function. So this train function takes our model and all the data points and the corresponding labels, and we also have an epoch parameter that allows us to specify how long the Perceptron should be training. So then, similar to what we discussed in the previous videos, we will iterate over the training epochs. And for each training epoch, here we will count the errors, just as a visualization to see when does the perceptron stop learning. Then for each training epoch, we iterate over the training examples here. And for each training example, we compute the error and do the model update, and also update the error count so that we can later see how many errors the perceptron is making after the training. So let's actually run this code and see what happens. So here we use a fresh perceptron initialized with weights 0 and bias unit 0. And then we will run the train function for 5 epochs. And we can see that in the first epoch, the perceptron makes 1 error. The second epoch is actually worse. There are now 3 errors. In the third epoch, we have 1 error. However, after the third epoch, we see that the perceptron is now able to classify the data set correctly. So the error of the fourth epoch is actually 0, and the error of the fifth epoch is also 0. Yeah, now we have a working perceptron here. In the next video, let's take a look at its decision boundary.